Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to the Ateneo Department of Economics and the Ateneo Center for Economic Research and Development webinar series. I am your host, Joselito Sescon from the Department of Economics, Ateneo de Manila. We are on our third to the last of our webinar series for this first semester 2022. Today, our topic is CGE simulation of the impacts of climate disasters in Naga and Iloilo. Before we begin, let me enumerate some house rules. We will let the speaker finish his presentation before we entertain questions. Zoom participants, kindly stay muted and stop sharing your video. Refrain from sharing your video during the duration of the presentation. During the question and answer portion, please virtually raise your hand and wait for to be acknowledged. You may unmute and show yourself when asking your question. Participants on the FB page, please post your question in the comment section. Slides, videos, and other materials from the seminar series are posted in our website only when the speaker gives his consent for sharing them. Okay, let me introduce our speaker for today, CJ Castillo, or Ruly Czar Joseph Castillo, or CJ Castillo, is a lecturer of the Department of Economics, Ateneo de Manila University. He obtained his Master of Arts in Mathematics in 2020 from the Institute of Mathematics, UP Diliman, and he is currently pursuing his MS Master of Science in Applied Math from the same university. His areas of interest are optimization and numerical methods in optimization, PDEs and dynamical systems, agent-based modeling, and Keynesian economics. He is also a program coordinator of the Labor and Research Network. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome CJ Castillo on the topic CGE, or Computable General Equilibrium Simulation of the Impacts of Climate Disasters on the Cities of Naga and Iloilo. CJ?
Thank you, sir. May I share my screen?
Please go ahead.
Okay, I hope you can see my slides.
Thank you, CJ. Let me remind the participants to mute their speakers.
Okay. Hi, everyone, and thank you for this opportunity to share our work. I will be presenting the results of our study on behalf of the research team. Just a disclaimer, although the title says simulation of climate disasters, in this talk, I will also present simulation of other disasters, not just climate disasters. Okay, so these are disasters experienced by Naga and Iloilo. These are namely COVID-19 pandemic and the African swine fever. Well, these challenges occurred when in 2020 when we perhaps started doing the study. Okay, so they are covered in the study. Here's the outline of my presentation. First, I will give a short introduction about the study, about the project. And second, I'll discuss climate disasters and other disasters experienced in Naga and Iloilo. Okay. And then before I go to the simulation results, I'll give a brief overview of CGE modeling. And I will also discuss the CGE models that we use for Iloilo and Naga City. Okay. And finally, I will end the talk with some challenges and lessons, okay, and ways forward. So let us start. Okay. This presentation aims to demonstrate the use of CGE models in disaster evaluation. And by the way, this presentation is based on two studies under the Coastal Cities at Risk, or the CICAR project. Okay, the studies cover Iloilo City and Naga City. These are partner LGUs. And the studies were conducted jointly in 2021 with partners from Naga City LGU, the Iloilo City LGU, Ateneo de Naga, and UP Visayas. And both studies aim to develop CGE models to help LGUs evaluate the impact of climate and other disasters that they may face, no, in the future on their local economies. And the simulations should serve as guide in crafting responses to disasters and in building resilience. Okay. Now, apart from the studies, okay, we also conducted CGE modeling training in 2021, where the participants include representatives from LGUs. Okay. So we introduced the participants to CGE modeling as a technique. Okay. And by the way, the research team is composed of, so we have, I think I saw Dr. Gay De Fiesta in our meeting today. Okay. We also have Franco from the Iloilo City LGU. We also have Doc Marlin Tejada from Ateneo de Naga, and Frances Nubla from Ateneo de Naga, and Sir Willie Prilius from Naga CPDO, and James, okay, from Naga CPDO. Meanwhile, the Ateneo de Manila team is composed of Dr. Ramon Clarete and Dr. Randy Tuano as the lead researchers here. We also have Majo, okay, from the Department of Economics, and of course, Simon. Okay. The SICARP project is led by Dr. Emma Porio. Okay. Now let's look at climate disasters, response, and resilience. Natural disasters such as typhoons and flooding are among the development challenges in the Philippines. And although their impacts are felt in the entire country, their effects at the local level are more pronounced. Okay. Now, in the Philippines, disaster risk reduction and management has been devolved to local governments. Okay. This is by virtue of RA 10 or 10121 or the Philippine Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Act of 2010. Because of this, cities and municipalities are tasked with planning and implementing their own DRRM programs. Iloilo City and Naga City are among the most proactive cities in terms of disaster risk reduction. Okay? And but both cities still experience destructive climate disasters. For instance, in Iloilo City, we had they had Typhoon Frank. This was in 2008. No, so please disregard this. No? This was in 2008. In Naga City, in 2020, they were exposed to three typhoons, so namely Quinta, and then a typhoon named after me, so Rolly and Ulysses. Okay, these are strong typhoons that we experienced in 2020 in the middle of the pandemic. Now, although these cities have proactive policies in terms of DRRM, they remain vulnerable to the hazards of climate disasters. Climate disasters impair the economy, so jobs are affected, economic activities are affected, and this causes income and welfare losses. Okay. Now, here is the Iloilo City flood susceptibility map. Okay. The dark blue areas, so as you can see here, are areas that have very high susceptibility to flooding. Okay. So this is Iloilo City. Okay. We got this from La Serena et al. This is in 2017. Okay. So a sizable area in Iloilo City is very prone to flooding. So meanwhile, let's look at the hazard map of Naga City. Okay. So the red areas here represent areas that have very high hazard level. Okay. And here are some pictures. These pictures were taken in Naga City right after the typhoons in 2020. This one is after Typhoon Rolly. This I think this one is in this was taken in November 1. This one is in November 12, right after Typhoon Ulysses. Okay, three typhoons in a row. But typhoons are not just the disasters that this local government space. In 2020, we had the COVID-19. So the pandemic hit the Philippines and it also spread in Iloilo City and Naga City. And although both cities showed commendable management of the spread of the disease, the pandemic still negatively affected their local economies. Okay? We also had the African swine fever sometime in 2020, but it mostly affected Luzon, okay? And Naga City was also affected. Iloilo City is not so much affected by the ASF. Okay? Now, analytical tools such as the computable general equilibrium or CGE model can help LGUs assess the impact of climate and other disasters. Now, in this talk, we will demonstrate the use of CGE models in disaster evaluation. Okay. So let's have a brief overview of CGE modeling. Okay. CGE models are standard tools in economic analysis. Okay. They are mostly used in determining how shocks affect the economy. Okay. These are typically deterministic models, but it's also possible to conduct stochastic simulations. You just need to tweak the model. Okay. CGE models are commonly employed where shocks are fully known, such as, for instance, we want to assess the impact of trade on our economy. Or if we have tax reform, we can also use CGE model. Okay. And simulations with CGE models cover all markets, unlike when you do partial equilibrium analysis, where you only focus on particular markets. Now, compared to input-output multiplier analysis, CGE models are more flexible because you can set the behavior of your economic agents. Okay. Now, most people think that CGE models are black boxes. Well, I think in general, computer softwares are black boxes also, no? But it's very possible to peek inside the black box if you have the appropriate background about the technique, no? Like, for instance, this one, CGE modeling. CGE models are essentially macroeconomic models, but they are built from microeconomic behavior of agents. Okay, so based on what we learned from microeconomics, consumers maximize utility subject to their budget constraint. Meanwhile, producers maximize their profit by producing a level of output where their marginal revenue equals their marginal cost. Now, if we consider all of this, okay, so the utility maximization behavior of consumers and the profit maximization behavior of producers, this is what characterize CGE models. Now, a very crucial assumption in CGE models is that the economic agents are rational. Okay, now let's take a look at how does a CGE model look like? Okay, let's take a look at its components. CGE models mainly have two parts. So first, we have a database called Social Accounting Matrix or SAM. If you have seen an input-output table, the SAM looks very much like an input-output table, except that there are more information in a SAM because in a SAM there are inter-institutional transactions. Okay. The other part of the model is the model itself. No, this is a set of equations that describe the behavior of economic agents. Actually, a CGE model is an optimization problem based on the rational behavior of agents. The solution of the model is an equilibrium state of an economy. And shocks affect the economy. No, they perturb the model and cause the economy to move from one equilibrium point to another. Now, see, analysis using CGE model compares equilibrium under the shock and or against the baseline, so meaning no shock. So that's how we do analysis using CGE models. Now, let me show you an example of a social accounting matrix. Most social accounting matrices look like this. It's just a table. Okay, each of the entries here represent the transaction carried out by economic agents. Okay, So this value right here, for instance, is the amount of, well, actually this one is a little harder to describe, no? But this one's more concrete, okay? So this one is the amount paid by household to a particular sector, okay? So this one is the amount consumed by household. So goods and services consumed by household. This value right here, H2, is the amount paid by the household to the government, perhaps in terms of taxes. Okay.
Hi, CJ. Are you pointing up? Do you have a pointer?
Sorry. Yeah, because I have a pointer. Let me.
We cannot see what you're pointing at.
There. Okay. Again. Okay. In a sum, so the sum summarizes the transactions in an economy at a particular time. Okay. This is just a table of transactions. Okay. So how you read the sum is like this. The column entity right here pays this much to the row entity. So this one here, this value right here, is the amount paid by household for goods and services that it consumed. Okay. Meanwhile, this amount right here is the amount paid by household to the government, perhaps in terms of taxes. Okay. So this amount right here is the value paid by economic activities for commodities. So these are intermediate inputs in production. This amount right here is the value paid by economic activities to factors of production, labor and capital. So this one is for capital. Okay. So one of the important characteristics of a sum is that the sum, no, yung total, okay, SUM, the sum across a particular row, so this row right here, for instance, is equal to the sum across the corresponding column. So this one, this activity row right here, take the sum, okay, this should be equal to the sum of activity column, okay? The reason is that if you notice, these values along the row, these are the earnings of this entity, okay? So therefore, this sum is the total earnings of the entity, okay? Meanwhile, the entries along a column are the expenditure items or the amount spent by the entity. And row sum equals column sum implies that all the sum of incomes equals all expenditures. So economic agents are spending within their income. Okay. So that's a very important assumption in social accounting matrices. Oops. Okay, let's move forward. This is another representation of social accounting matrix. Okay, but this time we use networks. Okay. Actually, this is just an extension of your typical circular flow of values in basic economics. No? In our simple circular flow of values, you only have household here and then firm on the other side. Okay. And then we have the flow of values. Okay. Factors of production are supplied by household to the firms. Meanwhile, households buy goods and services from firms. Okay. We just extend that diagram. So we include here more details. For instance, we have the external economy, rest of the world. We have the government. So it's right here, the financial institutions, savings and investment, and all their transactions. Okay. Now, this is how a CGE model looks like. It's actually just a computer program. Okay. Well, you can. It's difficult to solve a CGE model analytically or by hand. No? So what we do is we numerically solve CGE models using software such as GAMS. This one is GAMS. And there's another software called Gempack. Okay. Okay, now let's look at the models for Iloilo and Naga City. Okay, these are the economic sectors covered in the Naga and Iloilo models. Okay, some they have common sectors, no? But for instance, in Naga City, we isolated hog raising sector from agriculture. Okay, that's because In Naga City, we are interested in modeling the impact of the African swine fever. Okay, so I think there are about maybe 20 or maybe 19 sectors in each of the cities. Now, the factors of production covered in the model are the following. We have the unskilled labor, skilled labor, and capital. Of course, the label unskilled here is just, this is just a label to denote labor with at most high school level of education, or I think elementary level of education, okay? Now, institutions, so we have the households, okay? We have the firm, we have the government, and we create a savings investment account. This is a fictitious account. And we also have the rest of the world. Well, in this case, since we are modeling just city economies, rest of the world means areas outside the city. Okay. So for instance, the other province, okay, Metro Manila is part of rest of the world for these cities. Now, the social accounting matrix is a very important component of CGE models. Okay. And it's really not easy to build models or build sums, even at the national level, okay? It's more difficult to build sums for city level economy because data are not really very available, okay? So these are, when we constructed the sums for Naga and Iloilo, we used several databases or all data sources that are available. So we listed down the data sources. So we have the LGU BPLO database of registered businesses, because we need information about how much businesses earn, how much sectors produce. Okay. We also use the FIES-LFS merge data set. We also use data from BLGF, BESF data to complement financial statement data set from the LGUs. And this is very important, the national input and input-output table, because the intermediate input submatrix of your sum can only be derived from national input-output table because we don't have city-level input-output tables. So we are assuming that economic activities in cities use the same production technology as in the national level. So this is very important assumption in modeling. Okay. And finally, we also use flow of commodities database to generate values for imports and exports of goods and services for the cities. Okay, now let me show you the aggregation structure that we use in the model. So value is produced in the model based on this aggregation structure. So first, we combine factors of production to produce value added. So right here, value added. Okay, this usually follows a Cobb-Douglas production function. Okay. Then we combine value added with intermediate inputs. These are intermediate inputs to produce domestic product. Okay. The aggregation here follows a Leontief production function. Okay. Now the sectors, they decide whether to sell outside of their economy or in their domestic economy. Okay. And this one is governed by a CET function, that's a constant elasticity of transformation. And finally, so we adopt this assumption that consumers in the local economy consume a combination of locally produced goods, so this one, DO, and imported goods, so goods and services that were produced outside of the economy. This is what's called the Armington assumption. And at this level, this follows, usually it's just Cobb-Douglas, okay? So this is how value is created in the model. Now let me show you functional forms used in the model. We only have a few, okay, here. So we have the CET function, which is given by this equation. We also use the CES function. The CES function can transform depending on the parameter used. You can generate a Cobb-Douglas function from this from this equation, you can also generate a Leontief function. Okay. And of course, we have the income balance equation. This is just linear. On one side, we take all the sum of incomes. Okay. On the other side, on the left hand side, the sum of expenses. Okay. In our modeling, we don't really solve a constraint optimization problem. What we do, we transform constraint optimization problems. So we transform this nonlinear program into what's called a mixed complementarity problem. Okay. Now for this, we refer you to these readings. So we have Rutherford and Marcosin, which provides a very good introduction to mixed complementarity problems. Actually, this is the manual of MPSG, you know, the subsystem that we are using to model. Okay. Now, in a mixed complementarity problem, a given inequality is associated with a particular variable based on economic theory. So for instance, if the profit from the production of a good is negative, then the production level for such good is zero. Okay. Meanwhile, if the supply of a good exceeds its demand, then the price for that good is zero. So idea here is that a variable and its complementary variable must be orthogonal. So meaning when you do the dot product, you produce a zero. No, that's what it means when you say orthogonal. Now, one of the advantages of a mixed complementarity problem is that we no longer need to solve a nonlinear programming problem, so there's no more objective function. What we have is a square system of equations and inequalities. Okay. And the solution of this system of equations and inequalities is the general equilibrium. Okay. But we don't do this manually. We use softwares. So we mainly use the MPSG subsystem of the GAMS software. This is very convenient because we do not need to type functional forms anymore. What we just need to do is to calibrate the model, which means we set the parameters of the model. So the coefficients of the functions. That's all we need to do. And the values come from the sum. Okay. We don't estimate CGA models because it's really hard. That's a very big system. It's hard to estimate parameters for that system. Instead, we calibrate these models. Okay. Now let me go through the, before I present to you the results, let me just show you the shocks that we simulated in this exercise. I'll be choosing the results that I'll present to you because we have limited time. Okay. So here are the shocks that we solved in this study. So for Naga City, we have the 2020 typhoons in Taroli and Ulysses. For other shocks, we also simulated the impact of COVID-19 pandemic on the local economies in 2020. Okay. And we also have the African swine fever, but this is just for Naga City. So in this case, no, it's African swine fever. We use a static model here. But for the typhoons and COVID pandemic, we use a dynamic or multi-period model, which I will discuss later. For Iloilo City, we simulated typhoon Frank. Actually, this is still work in progress. We haven't finalized the result yet. Because our earlier results, we still need to fine-tune them. Okay. But what I will be presenting to you later on are the results of COVID-19 pandemic simulation for Iloilo City. Okay. And the shock values were obtained from FGDs in Naga City and Iloilo City. In 2021, we conducted several FGDs, I think three, two in Naga and one in Iloilo. Okay, so from the FGDs, we generated shock values. Okay, we also tried to do survey to come up with some estimates of shocks, but we don't really, it's really hard to conduct surveys. First, they're expensive and sometimes people are not very motivated to participate in surveys. And although This should have been ideal. It's really difficult to pull off. Okay. And lastly, we also base our shock values from secondary data. Okay. So let me just mention this, no, multi-period simulation. CGE models are often static models, but you can do simulations over a period of time. Okay. In our case, we use multi-period recursive models. The model is solved for every period in your time horizon. Okay. And in each iteration, you change the value of the shock. So in the case of disasters, the solution of dynamic models can be used to track the movement of economy toward recovery. Okay. Now let me show you the results of our simulations. So first, let us look at Naga City. So here is the shock values that we use in our simulation. So here, to simulate the impact of typhoons, we introduce shocks to labor and capital endowments of the economy. Okay. So in the first period, we still have here full employment, and then when the typhoons struck the area, the availability of labor and capital is reduced. So that's the depth of displacement of labor and capital. Okay, and over time, as the city recovers, so are labor and capital endowments. No, see, they go back to their normal levels. Now let's look at the simulation results. Here, I'll only focus on the impact on output. These are the effects on output, okay, due to the typhoon. Oops. Oh, there's something missing here for services. Okay. But anyway, all of the sectors are negatively affected, but some sectors are more affected than others. There should be another plot here for services. Okay. The plot here shows that some service activities recover faster than other sectors. So for instance, financial sector recovers really fast. Okay. Now let's look at another scenario. Here we are simulating COVID-19 restrictions. So by the way, the time horizon here is in weeks. Okay. Our time frame is from March to December 2020. The line here shows you the displacement rate of labor, because COVID-19 restrictions really did not damage capital of economic activities. It only displaced labor. So during these months, we still had very strict lockdown. Okay, labor, the only amount of labor available is just this much. Okay, that's just about 50%. No? And then as the local government relaxes restrictions, the availability of labor also increases. Now let's look at the simulation results. So here, oh, by the way, if you notice, labor here does not fully recover. Okay. By December 2020, the availability is still around maybe 80%, more than 80%. Maybe that's 89% or 87%. So let's look at the impacts on output. Here, I'll show you the impacts on agricultural sector. Okay. Notice that they don't really fully recover because labor does not recover fully also. This one is for industrial activities. Note that some sectors are more affected than others. And here is for service activities. So there's an outlier here. This is financial sector. Okay. So the reason some sectors are more affected than others is due to their reliance on factors of production. Some sectors rely so much on labor. Some sectors do not rely so much on labor, like the financial sector. You may remember from your international economics, we have the Rybczynski theorem, which says something about the how a sector is affected by when the availability of factors of production change. Okay, so when their intensive factor increases in supply, you know, they tend to benefit. But that's of course relative to other factors of production. Okay, this one is the impact in terms of GDP. You can also compute the impact in terms of GDP. So you can see here the economy of Naga does not fully recover. This is still the COVID-19 scenario. Okay. So next simulation exercise is this African swine fever. These are our scenarios. First, suppose ASF caused 60% reduction in hogs sector output. Okay. The 60% is derived from LGU data. Okay. The other scenario is that when you have ASF, okay, your import of when the price of imported pork rises, okay, this case we increase the price of imported pork by 23%, which is the average increase in pork prices in the Philippines. The third scenario is both of these shocks occur. Now let's look at the results. So here is the impact of ASF. Now let me just explain. These are relative values. The baseline level is 1. So you need to compare the values here to 1. When the values here exceed 1, that means there's an increase for instance, this one in output. Okay. When the value is below 1, that means there is reduction in value. Okay. So as you can see here in terms of output, so this column right here, the impact of ASF is only felt in the hog sector. So it's very concentrated, very focused. The other sectors are not really impacted, are not really affected. And this is because if you look at the social accounting matrix, the hog sector is not intensively used in any other sectors. And if you look at Armington prices, these are prices actually. It's all also virtually unchanged. There's some increase. Actually, this is Armington, the amount of goods supplied in the economy, okay, for final consumption. It's also virtually unchanged. Imports, because of the hogs of the ASF, Naga City imported more pork. This is by 3.6%. But look at the price of domestic good, okay? Because production fell, the price of domestic or locally produced pork increased. This one is a very high increase, no? That's 1.5 times 100%. Okay. Now let's look at the second scenario. Oops. Let's look at the second scenario. There. Okay. So this time we are increasing the price of imported pork. Okay. There's really not much change in output. Okay. If you notice, the output of hog sector fell by maybe about 11%. Okay. Let's look at the price of, but look, the price of pork in Naga City increased by 20%. Okay. Again, we only increase import price here. Now let's look at the final scenario where we have both shocks occurring. So here, combined shocks, no? So we reduce the output of hog sector and we also increase the price of imported pork. So as you can see here, the price of domestic good as expected increased, and so is the price of Armington good. Okay. Consumption of hogs of pork rather, no, also fell. Again, the impact on other sectors is very minimal. That is because hogs is not very integrated to the other sectors. Okay, now let's look at simulation results for Iloilo City. I only have 3 minutes left. Okay, so here we are simulating COVID-19, and here are the average labor displacement rates and average labor endowment availability. This is just 1 minus the displacement rate now. Okay. So here's the effect on agricultural output. So as expected, both sectors, agriculture, this is agriculture, and the orange one is for fisheries. The output of agricultural activities fell because of the pandemic, but there's some recovery when the labor endowment recovered. And this one is for industrial activities. Again, there are sectors that are not so affected by the shock. And this one is for services. Look at this one. It's the green one represents the real estate. So this is something that was produced by the simulation. Okay. So it's the only sector that gained in terms of output. Now we can also measure, this one is in terms of GDP, okay, Iloilo City weekly GDP. There's some reduction because of the pandemic. Now we can measure the damage to welfare in terms of the equivalent variation, okay? So when you have a negative value here, that means utility of consumers decreased. But this time, this one is represented by change in income, okay? So if you want to mitigate the impact, you may need some amount that is equivalent to this area right here, okay? That's the amount of welfare lost on the part of consumers, okay? Now, before I end, let me just present some challenges, lessons, and ways forward from these simulation exercises. So first, data collection is really challenging. There's so much data used in CGE model building, no? And the best CGE models reflect or use data that reflect actual experiences on the ground. And as much as possible, shocks must also be based on data. But sometimes it's really hard to collect data. In our case, we had difficulty pulling off a survey. Okay. So we had to resort to other ways of obtaining values for our shocks. Second, modeling is a participative process. Okay? You need to consult your partners about how you modeled a particular shock. Maybe they have suggestions on how to improve the modeling, or rather the model or the shock. Okay? And modeling process can also be interdisciplinary. And future work, these are just some of the things that we can still do in the future. We can improve the design of shocks by integrating CGE models with other modeling techniques, for instance, in physical sciences, in other social sciences. One of the more interesting modeling exercises that we can do since we're still in the COVID pandemic is to integrate CGE models with epidemiological models. Okay, and since machine learning techniques are becoming more popular, perhaps we can also use them in estimating SAMs in the absence of actual data. And finally, this one is very, ambitious. Okay, perhaps we can start working on building CGE solvers. Okay, because CGE softwares are really expensive. All right, so these are our references, and that ends the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, CJ, for that introduce to the audience as well. For those who are not yet very familiar with CGE, for CJ has introduced that the principles and concepts, but as well as to the application in getting the estimates on the shocks as it happens in the cities of Iloilo and Naga. So Let's have questions from participants. I'll just raise your virtual hand. Kindly introduce yourself. There's a Dr. Rulano Briones. Sir.
Hi. Good morning. Thanks, CJ. I feel bad that the notice for this meeting came late, so I kind of missed the first part. So I understand that you're doing a weekly equilibrium, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
CJ.
Yes, sir. For the COVID simulation and typhoon simulation.
So I'm checking if Randy is here. I think he's not. But anyway, from previous work of Randy, and I'm assuming you also did, you just simply divided by annual data by 52 weeks. Is that how you
Yes, sir. That's what we did. So we built an annual sum, and then we divided the values by, 51? Was it 51 or something?
52 weeks, yeah.
52 weeks, yeah.
So... it all depends on your philosophy of or your opinion of how quickly the economy reaches equilibrium. I'm a bit more comfortable with the assumptions where economy reaches equilibrium slower. But weekly, my impression is that's kind of pushing it, no? I find it, frankly, quite a stretch to assume that an economy reaches equilibrium. Now, of course, equilibrium is important as a simplifying assumption. So I accept that. And if I'm forced to do that, I'll probably do that as well. But I do have my misgivings. And I'm wondering if you have a sub-annual projection that is necessary, maybe some more complicated formulation involving disequilibrium, accepting some disequilibrium or some econometric error correction thing might be more appropriate.
Oh, that's, I think you're raising a very interesting point here. Well, the solution of our modeling is actually just based on the shock that we introduce into the model. And the shock over time is based on the responses of our FGD participants. So for instance, in the case of typhoons, you may think that a recovery in maybe 6 weeks is relatively fast. But if you compare that, for instance, during the time of Ondoy, if I remember, it took more than some months before Marikina or Pasig fully recovered. In the case of typhoons, based on the responses of our of FGD participants, recovery is relatively faster. It only took them about maybe a month, so that's just 4 weeks. So it's really based on.
I'm not really talking about recovery. No, I'm talking about market clearing.
Ah, sir, the market clearing.
Because about that one. If you present solutions like. Because if I understand your model correctly, you're presenting supply-demand projections at equilibrium, where supply equals demand. But that requires a prior assumption that if your period of analysis is weekly, that supply, that the market's clear every week.
Sir, right? Actually, the solution is instantaneous. So in every period, that's the equilibrium.
So whatever period you adopt, that's the equilibrium. That's the assumption I'm questioning.
I haven't seen CG models yet, but we'll look into your.
So I'm saying we have to step back a little bit and wonder whether CG models are still suitable when your period is weekly. For annually, I think you can still make that case, no?
Yeah.
But if your period is weekly, I think it's a little bit stressing the conceptual framework. And maybe something else might be warranted given that. For instance, farmers, when they harvest rice, they don't sell at once. They text and look for their buyers, et cetera, looking for the right price. And it could take 1 to 2 weeks, more than 1 week at least, no? So if the search process takes more than 1 week, I find it less than plausible to assume that the entire economy achieves a general equilibrium 52 times a year.
Yeah, actually, that's a very good point, sir. The result of simulation is really just the solution of instantaneous solution of the model. So one can really question whether that really reflects what happens on the ground, where people take time, like negotiating for prices and so forth and so on. Maybe that negotiation can take place more than a week and so forth. And I'm glad that you pointed that out. That's something that we really need to, of course, all models have limitations, and I guess CGI models, these are not really perfect tools, no? But we can, they're still useful in some cases, or in a lot of cases, maybe.
Just one more point, Mr. Sescon. No? I like your point about the solvers, freeware solvers, but for that, you have to step out of GAMS.
Yeah. We're looking at using free programming languages like R or Python.
I would encourage you to create a community.
We have
freeware. invite me, please.
Oh yeah, sure.
I'm desperately looking for a community of CGE modelers around open source software. Sorry, this is a little bit of trade information. What are you exploring now? Is it Julia? Is it Python? What are you exploring now?
We're looking at Python or maybe R or any other freewares out there where we can implement numerical solutions.
Have you tried Jump? Julia Jump?
No, not yet, sir. But we'll look into it. I think it really doesn't matter which software or which platform you use. What matters is the solver, which is the mathematical algorithm.
Basta libre, no?
Basta libre.
Another thing I've seen is Pyomo. Not Python, pero the specific Pyomo. Kasi it accepts the indexical system that is very favorable for systems like GAMS or GEMPA. That's actually the power of this software, no? This commercial software, this indexical or set theoretic nomenclature. Yeah. Not that readily available in Python or Julia unless you explore some specialized packages. Anyway, sorry. Okay, that's all.
No, I'm so glad you mentioned yung free softwares because my colleagues are here. We've been discussing developing solvers. that we can distribute for free.
Okay. I don't see anyone raising their hand as of now. That's why I did not interfere in your quiet discussion of the solvers. But okay. CJ, since there are no questions yet,
there's a hand being raised, sir.
I cannot see it. Can you kindly unmute yourself, please, if I don't see your hand? Mayumi Tibes, okay, please.
Hello po. Good morning, sir. First off, I want to thank Sir CJ for that presentation. Thank you so much. I've read some of your papers before, sir, and I'm pretty surprised that you really specialize in optimization because I'm also very interested in it as well. My question is, a little bit of a noob question because I'm new to the CGE, method of optimization. So my question is, could you have easily just as easily have used multi-objective linear programming in your simulation, and if so, why didn't you? Thank you so much, sir.
Actually, it's possible to use linear functions. It just so happened that in our modeling, we have nonlinear functions there. For instance, our utility function follows a Cobb-Douglas function, so that's nonlinear. But we can also use a linear function for that one. But I haven't seen CGE models that rely solely on linear functions. But I believe it's possible as long as if you're looking at linear programming, as long as you have a feasible region or a feasible program, then you'll find a solution.
Okay. Yeah. Dr. Briones again. Raising your hand, no?
Yeah. Just a follow-up to Mayumi's question. If your objective is a positive analysis of projection of the economy, then just state which objective, 1, 2, 3, probably lexicographic, no? That will, you think, plausibly describe what are the objectives of the agents in the economy that can be reflected in the equilibrium. And that will be. So right now, it's simply supply equals demand, mostly. Single objective function stated in the abstract. Nobody's actual objective, but, you know, just how the economy moves. Just how the economy... behaves over time. It's nobody's objective. It's like Darwin, no? Survival of the fittest. Nobody actually intends it. It just happens.
Thank you.
Okay.
Last question. Would it be possible to do the CGE simulation individually?
What do you mean individually?
This project this big, such project this big, would it be possible to do it, for example, if you're
by yourself?
Yes.
Yeah, I think so. Because my colleague Simon here, his thesis is CGE modeling. So he did it by himself.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
You just need to start at something, I think.
Okay, we're a few minutes, just about 3 minutes. CJ, can you elaborate on the assumption of the same technology at the national level if you're using an input-output table for a national and now you're applying it to a city level?
Yes, sir. What we mean by that is that because there's no input-output table at the city level, we only have one at the national level. We're using the technical coefficients from the national input-output table, and we are applying them on local economy. The difference, when you do this, you can still get a sum that reflects the structure of the economy at the local level. And the key here is to identify which sectors are present in your local economy. Of course, at the national level, if you look at the input-output table, say you have 65 sectors there, not all those sectors may be represented or are present in the local economy. So for instance, maybe in Naga City, there's no computer manufacturing. Okay, and you can get that information. In our case, we got that information from the database of businesses from Naga LGU. So that's a very important part of some building at local levels.
Okay, there's last question here in the chat box from Patricia Persia. How can an economy shocks to health, given that the scenarios are done to see shocks caused by health problems? How can an economy...
So if I understand your question correctly, suppose you have a health shock. Okay, how can that health shock affect the economy? Maybe in the CGE framework. There are many ways. Actually, the how you build the shock, how you design the shock is more of an art, I think. So for instance, in that case, you can introduce a shock in terms of cost, healthcare cost for households. So that mainly affects their expenditures. So that's one. You can also introduce that or introduce a shock in terms of its impacts on labor endowments, because if people get sick, they cannot go to work. So that's another way of introducing that kind of shock. Okay. I think there are many ways to introduce shocks. It's just a matter of maybe it's more of an art than I think a science.
Okay. From Tammy, I see that you have used typhoons as a variable for climate change. Do we assume that due to climate change, the frequency of the typhoons increases, or is it based on the strength of the typhoon?
Are you referring to the impact on the economy?
Variable,
we cannot directly incorporate the strength of the typhoon on our model. What we did is we introduced shocks to labor and capital. Yes, okay, impact on the economy. So we introduced shocks to labor and capital endowments. Now, depending on the strength of the typhoon, we change the values of our endowments. Okay, so for instance, if typhoon is perhaps stronger, you can assume that your labor and capital endowments, or rather your capital, physical capital, gets damaged more. So your available capital is less. So, you know, something about, you can model it that way. But in general, we cannot directly incorporate typhoon strength or climate change. We need to transform that scenario first into a shock that we can work with in our model.
Okay, thank you very much, CJ. I think we don't have much time anymore. Thank you very much, CJ. I think it will inspire a lot of us now being introduced to CGE modeling. It's challenging, but I think as you begin to be familiar with it, you'd like that. I think you will like it, like just like CJ. I just want to say to plug in for our next seminar, next webinar, that will be on November 23, Proof Social Motivations for Making Against COVID-19 in the United States, an Empirical Application of Protection Motivation Theory for Pandemic Settings. Our speaker is Vanessa T. Ban, the lecturer of the Ateneo Department of Economics. That will be November 23. So please register. And for the materials from our previous seminars, you can visit our Ateneo Department of Economics website. And for the Economic Seminar Series videos, it's available on the Facebook page of the Department of Economics.